أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والذين هاجروا في الله من بعد ما ظلموا لنبوئنهم في الدنيا حسنة ولأجر الآخرة أكبر لو كانوا يعلمون الذين صبروا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
A second for the love of Imams Al-Hasan Wal-Hussein A third for the love of Fatima to Zahra with your loudest voices.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The first of Muharram signifies the first day or the beginning of the Hijri New Year. The Hijri calendar begins with the Hijra of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi from Mecca to Medina. Hence, there are some that presume that the hijrah of Rasulullah, the migration of Rasulullah from Mecca to Medina occurred in Muharram, since the month of Muharram is the beginning of the Hijri calendar. They assume that Rasulullah migrated in the month of Muharram. We shall examine this. And we shall correct this misconception. There are some on the same line, there are some that ask, who is the first who made the Hijri calendar? Where did the Hijri calendar come from? Was it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Did he establish the Hijri calendar? Or was it someone else? Also, there are some that assume the first of Muharram should be celebrated. Since it is the first day out of the new year, we should celebrate this day. Is this correct? Is this a day of celebration or is it a day of mourning? And also, since we're speaking about Hijrah, the Hijri calendar and the Hijrah, the migration of Rasulullah, what were the reasons that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi migrated from Mecca to Medina? This is the first discussion of tonight's topic. The second is that today we see on the news there's a mass migration. There's a major wave of migration of people coming from Iraq, from Syria, and from other countries that are migrating to the West. People are leaving by the thousands. They're leaving their homes, their country, their lands, and they're moving to a new country. Some are leaving because of terrorism that has victimized them in their countries. Others are leaving due to oppression. Others are leaving due to poverty. Others are leaving due to the bad management of their countries. For the many different reasons why they are migrating, today we see tens of thousands that are leaving their countries and are moving to the West. They're moving to Europe and other places, other continents. Such migration, number one, it opens the door of opportunity. It opens for them the doors of opportunity. Number two, it also comes with challenges. With opportunities come challenges. And number three, these people, they have a lot of responsibility towards themselves and towards their children. This is the second discussion that we will address. And number three, on the topic of migration, we shall remember the one that migrated from Medina to Karbala. The one who migrated with his family members, his close companions, his sisters and his daughters, who left his hometown of Medina and who came to settle in the city of Karbala. Thus, tonight we will divide our topic into three sections. The first, our topic is migration and Islam. We shall give the first section to the migration of Rasulullah, the second section to the migration to the West, and number three, the migration of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Send the loud salawat. When did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi migrate from Mecca to Medina? There are some that assume it's in Muharram, but this is not correct. Yes, the Hijri calendar begins with Muharram, and the Hijri calendar begins with the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. But was the migration in Muharram? No. According to most historians, professional historians, from both schools of thought, Sunni and Shi'i schools of thought, even Orientalists that have talked about the biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, they mention that the migration of Rasulullah was not in the month of Muharram. Rather, it was in the month of Safar. Precisely on the 24th of Safar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi left Mecca. And he arrived to Medina, which was known as Yathrib when Rasulullah arrived. And then it was named Medina, Medina to Rasulullah. Later on, Rasulullah arrived on the 8th of Rabi'ul Awwal. He left Mecca on the 24th of Safar, and he arrived Medina on the 8th of Rabi'ul Awwal. Now, this proves to us that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi did not migrate in the month of Muharram. This is very important. This is very important. Why? Because according to our Sunni brothers and sisters, there are some narrations that they have in Bukhari and others that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi arrived to Medina, arrived to Yathrib on the 10th of Muharram. And when he arrived on the 10th of Muharram, which is Ashura, he found Jews and Christians of Medina to be fasting. He asked them, "Why are you fasting on this day?" They said, "This is a day of holiday. This is the day that Allah did this, He did that, He rescued Musa, He rescued Ibrahim." And they made a whole list. Thus, today is a holiday. That is why we fast. Rasulullah stated, "Okay, since Jews and Christians, they fast on Ashura, we Muslims, we will also fast on this day, the day of Ashura." You see, they build this whole theory of fasting on Ashura on this premise. That Rasulullah arrived to Medina on the 10th of Muharram, on the day of Ashura. While the correct history tells us that Rasulullah arrived to Medina on the 8th of Rabi' al-Awwal. He did not even arrive in Muharram. He did not arrive on Ashura. Thus, this whole idea of fasting on Ashura is all but a lie, and it's a fallacy. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Who is the founder of the Hijri calendar? Who is the one that decided that the Islamic calendar will begin with the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Was it Rasulullah himself? No. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi did not set this calendar. In fact, during the days of Rasulullah, there was no calendar. There were no dates. The events, they were known, the years were known by certain events. Certain events. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, which year was he born? There's no number. He was born on the year of the elephant, Am al-Fil. The years were known by the, not by numbers, but by events. Am al-Fil. Am al-Huzn. The year that Sayyidina Abu Talib and Sayyidina Khadija passed away, that year was known as Am al-Huzn. It doesn't have a number. The year that Rasulullah migrated was known as Am al-Hijrah. The year of the peace treaty at Hudaybiyah was known as Am al-Hudaybiyah. The year of the conquest of Mecca, Am al-Fath. The year that Rasulullah performed his last Hajj, Am al-Wada', Am Hajjat al-Wada', and so on and so forth. Thus, during the life of Rasulullah, there was no calendar, there were no years. So who made the Hijri calendar? According to historians, the one who established the Hijri calendar was Umar ibn al-Khattab. Now how did this occur? Some historians, they mentioned that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, who was the governor of Basra at the time, and this was 17 years after the Hijra of Rasulullah, he complained to Umar ibn al-Khattab that the letters that you are sending me and I'm sending you, they don't have dates. Thus, I'm not sure, did this letter come first or that letter come first? Because there's no dates. Here, some historians, they say that Umar ibn al-Khattab thought of establishing a calendar and beginning that calendar with the migration of Rasulullah from Mecca to Medina. And these historians, they say that Uthman ibn Affan advised him to begin this Hijri calendar with Muharram. Now this is one side of the story. However, when we come to the history of Ahlul Bayt, yes, we agree that it was Umar ibn al-Khattab that founded the Hijri calendar. However, it was because he sought the advice of Ali ibn Abi Talib, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Umar complained to Amir al-Mu'mineen that we have a problem. We need to set our dates Amir al-Mu'mineen gave him the advice that the calendar should be set from the Hijrah of Rasulullah, and it should begin with the month of Muharram. And it was one of these, instances, an incident that Umar was known for his famous quote, "Lawla Aliyun, lahalak Umar." If it wasn't Ali ibn Abi Talib, Umar would have perished. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Why did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi migrate from Mecca to Medina? Rasulullah was born in Mecca. He was raised in Mecca. It was his land. It was his city. And he loved Mecca. لا أقسم بهذا البلد وأنت حل بهذا البلد. Rasulullah loved the city of Mecca. The day that he migrated, it was a very difficult day. It was a day that brought tears to the eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. So why would he leave his city? Why would he leave his country? You know, for many of us that migrated and left our cities and our countries, it was not an easy step. It was not an easy day to leave our countries and hometowns. So too for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. It was not easy. But why? You see, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi had a mission. His mission was to deliver the message of Allah to everyone, to the entire world, not just to the people of Mecca. In Mecca, people of Mecca were not receptive. They did not listen to him. Only a handful of people listened to him. They bothered him. They persecuted him. They hurt him physically, emotionally, psychologically. Him and his companions, many of Rasulullah's companions were massacred. They were killed. Yasir, the father of Ammar. Sumayya, the mother of Ammar. They were among the first martyrs in Islam at the hands of Quraysh, at the hands of the people of Mecca. Thus, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi in Mecca was extremely limited. There was only so much that he could do. Quraysh did not give him the opportunity to work. In fact, they came after persecuting, after hurting, after physically abusing Rasulullah. They saw that Rasulullah is relentless. There's nothing that they could do to make him stop delivering the message of Allah. They came to his uncle Abu Talib. They told him, "Ya Abu Talib, tell your nephew that if he wants money, we'll give him money. If he wants land, we'll give him land. If he wants to be the king, we'll make him our king. If he wants women, we'll give him the most beautiful of our women. But tell him to stop this nonsense called Islam." Abu Talib, this loyal and believing uncle of Rasulullah, he comes to him and he tells him the message of Quraysh. Here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, look at the determination of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. He said, "Wallahi ya am, law wada'u ash-shamsa fi yamini wal qamara fi shimali ala an atruka hadha al-amr la ma fa'altuhu ma taraktuhu hatta yudhhirahu Allah aw amuta duna." By God, I swear to you, my uncle, that if they put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, to give up, meaning if they give me everything, to give up this message, to abandon this message, I will never give up this message. Unless, until Allah shows Islam to the entire world, or I die. These are my two options. That Allah shows Islam to the entire world, or that I die. Otherwise, I will not give up this message. This is called determination, my dear friends. This is called working for Islam. This is how the message of Rasulullah reached us today, because of the determination of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the message that we have to learn from Rasulullah. Yesterday, I was with some brothers having dinner, and we met a sister from this community in Montreal. And I was told that the sister is extremely active in this community. And she had said a quote, she's famous for a quote, saying that if you're a follower of Ahlul Bayt, you have to be tired. When you fall asleep, you have to be tired. And I found this to be very inspirational. I decided from last night that I, whenever I sleep, I have to be extremely tired if I claim to be a follower of Ahlul Bayt. Of course, tired of what? Of working out or taking walks? Of what? Being tired of working for the sake of Ahlul Bayt, for delivering the message of Ahlul Bayt, for making sure that everyone knows of Ahlul Bayt. Being tired of this. This is being inspired by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Rasulullah could no longer work in Mecca. He was extremely limited. In fact, his movement was an underground movement. He would meet secretively with his companions in Shi'b Abi Talib and in other places. It was an underground movement. You could not make it public. And on top of that, in Mecca, Rasulullah lost two main supporters. Two big supporters. Number one, Abu Talib, and number two, Khadija, alayhum as-salam. These two supporters that stood with Rasulullah from day one, they recognized him as a prophet. They recognized him as a messenger. They believed in him. They were among the first to believe in him. Even though there are some that try to tell us that Abu Talib died as a kafir, that died as a mushrik, and that Abu Talib is burning in hellfire. You know why they say this? Because he had a crime. That crime was that he was the father of Ali ibn Abi Talib. If Abu Talib was the father of Muawiyah, we would have heard of other things. But because he's the father of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they tell us that he is burning in hellfire. And Abu Sufyan is enjoying himself in heaven. You see what they tell us? Rasulullah lost his two main supporters, Abu Talib and Khadija. And that year was known as Aam al-Huzn, the year of sadness. On top of that, the people of Medina, they came and they accepted the message of Rasulullah. They gave allegiance to Rasulullah. A group of them, they came and they gave allegiance. Rasulullah said, go back and bring me 12 men. 12 men of you from the city of Medina. Each man representing one of the tribes in Medina. Indeed, they came and they gave allegiance to Rasulullah. And that allegiance was called Bay'atul Aqaba. Bay'atul Aqaba. It was then and there that Rasulullah decided, of course, as a command by Allah, to leave the city of Mecca and to go to Medina. In Medina, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam had doors of opportunity. The people of Medina, they welcomed Rasulullah. Unlike the people of Mecca who persecuted and abused Rasulullah, the people of Medina were welcoming. They welcomed Rasulullah, they supported Rasulullah. It was in Medina that Rasulullah was able to establish the first mosque. It was in Medina that Rasulullah was able to establish brotherhood among the Muslims. It was in Medina that Rasulullah was able to establish an Islamic government. Moving to Medina opened lots of doors of opportunity for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Not only was Rasulullah required to migrate, you see, Rasulullah was ordered to migrate. Not only him, but all the believers and all the mu'mineen in Mecca, they were forced religiously. It became wajib upon them to migrate from Mecca to Medina. And Allah praises them. Allah praises the migrants, al-muhajireen, that those who came with Rasulullah from Mecca to Medina. And Allah praises those who were in Medina that welcomed Rasulullah, that supported him, that stood by his side. We see in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Allah praises the migrants, those who left their cities, those who left their homes, their families, their businesses, their wealth. Why? Only to migrate with Rasulullah, to support Rasulullah. Since Rasulullah left, they decided to leave with him. This is one group. And the other, وَالَّذِينَ آوَوا وَنَصَرُوا أُولَٰئِكَ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضُ. And those who supported Rasulullah, those who welcomed Rasulullah to Medina, those who welcomed Rasulullah with open arms and treated Rasulullah like a family member, those who stood by his side and were ready to take his cause and give him wives and give him money and give him lands, Allah praises both the migrants and the helpers, the muhajireen and the ansar. And on the contrary, those who believed in Rasulullah that yet you refuse to migrate, Allah scolds them. Now why didn't you migrate? Why didn't you leave with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يُهَاجِرُوا مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ وَلَايَتِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى يُهَاجِرُوا. Those who believed yet did not migrate, don't pay attention to them. Their belief is nonsense. It has no value. Because along with their belief, they had to migrate. You see, at that point, migration became wajib. It became a necessity. It became an obligation. Don't welcome them until they come and migrate to you. And we see that in the Quran, Allah praises those that were reluctant. In the beginning, they were reluctant. They refused to migrate. Well, obviously, when you have your home, your lands, your business, it's not easy to leave all of this, put it behind you and go to a place where you're a complete stranger, you don't own a land, you don't have a business. It's a challenge, it's a test. Yet, Allah says those that were reluctant in the beginning, yet then decided to migrate, they too, Allah will be pleased with them. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا مَعَكُمْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مِنْكُمْ. Those that believed and they migrated, but after you, they were reluctant, but they migrated after you, those two are considered with you. From these verses, we understand that migration at some times can become an obligation. Sometimes you don't have a choice but to migrate, but to leave your country and to go to another country. Sometimes it's not an option. It becomes mandatory. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ready? We read a verse in the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala scolds those that were able to migrate yet did not migrate. And they died in humiliation. They died out of oppression. Yes, they were oppressed. But they had the chance to migrate. But they didn't migrate. Allah tells us, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِيمَ كُنْتُمْ قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا فَأُولَئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. There was a group of people that did not migrate with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were believers, they were mu'mineen, they were Muslim, but they remained in Mecca. When Rasulullah migrated to Medina, at the Battle of Badr was between the Muslims in Medina and the Kuffar of Mecca, the Kuffar of Quraysh. The people of Quraysh, they forced some Muslims living in Mecca to come and join the battle in Badr. They forced some Muslims to come and fight Rasulullah. They were forced. They had no choice. If they were to leave, they would have been killed by the people of Mecca and Quraysh. And indeed, they came into the battle and they were killed by whom? By the army of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they died, of course, they had no choice. They had to fight and they were killed by the side of Rasulullah. This reminds me of the Iran-Iraq war. You know, a lot of the soldiers, Iran, of course, it's an Islamic country, it's a Shi'i country. And Iraq, many of the soldiers were also, they're also whom? Shia. Many of them were Shia. But they were forced to fight. They were forced by Saddam Hussein to fight, the Iranian army. And those who fled the army, they were killed. Anyhow, these people that were killed in Badr, they were Muslims that were killed by the army of Rasulullah. The angels, they asked them, why did you come and fight? They said, قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. We were oppressed. We were forced. The angels told them, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسَعَةً فَتُهَاجُرُوا فِيهَا. Aren't the lands of Allah so vast for you to leave? For you to migrate? Who forced you to remain in Mecca? Why did you remain in Mecca? Why didn't you leave? Thus, from this and other verses, we come to know that sometimes migration is an obligation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran praises Ahlul Kahf, the people of the cave. The people of the, you know, the cave is in modern day Jordan, is in Amman. I've visited it. I've been to Amman and I've visited the actual cave. If you ever happen to go to Jordan, Amman, go and visit the cave. The cave that has been mentioned in the Quran, Ahlul Kahf. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praise Ahlul Kahf? What's so special about Ahlul Kahf? The people of the cave, who were youth, they migrated. They lived in a country ruled by a ruthless tyrant, by a dictator, by the name of Diqyanus, who was a dictator. Instead of remaining in that country, being oppressed, being ruled by a ruthless tyrant, they decided to leave. They migrated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dedicates an entire chapter for the people of the cave. Al-Kahf, Surah Al-Kahf. And the Quran praises them. The Quran praises Ahlul Kahf for migrating. Prophet Musa alayhi salam, he lived in Egypt under the kingdom of Fir'aun. Yet a time came when Musa's life was in danger. He had to migrate. He had to leave. And indeed Musa left. He left Egypt. He left and he went to Midian, which is also in modern day Jordan. He remained there for 10 years with Prophet Shu'aib, and then he came back again to Egypt. And if we look at the lives of prophets and special people in other religion, in Islam and other previous nations, we'll probably find many examples of those that migrated. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Today, we see on the news that there is a mass migration. People are migrating by the thousands every day. As I speak to you now, there are people that are fleeing from Syria, from Iraq, from other parts of the Middle East, and they're heading west. People in Iraq and in Syria, some of them are fleeing from the oppression of ISIS, this cursed gang that has come into our countries. They're killing innocent people. They're not distinguishing between people's faiths. They kill Shi'i, they kill Sunni, they kill Yazidi, they kill Christians, that have destroyed so many lands and destroyed so many lives. There are some that are fleeing. Others are fleeing from the oppression of certain countries and certain governments. Some are fleeing from the ill services of certain governments, specifically in Iraq. In Iraq, the people of Iraq are suffering from a corrupt government, a government that is known for its corruption. Even though many of the people in government are Islamists, they claim to be Islamists, from an Islamist groups, political groups. Yet unfortunately, many of them have proven to be corrupt. Perhaps they don't kill, but they steal. Many people are fed up and they've decided to leave their homes and their countries and to head west. Even though migrating has not been easy, for some, it has put their lives into danger. Some risk their lives and the lives of their family members. I'm sure all of you, all of us, have not forgotten the image of the 4-year-old or 3-year-old Syrian girl that died, that drowned off the shores of Turkey. I'm sure her image is still in our minds and the minds of all those that saw the picture. That a day or 2 days later, they found the body of her brother that also drowned in the ocean as her parents were migrating from Syria and they were heading towards Europe. Thus, there are some people that were and are still willing to risk their lives and the lives of their family members, the lives of their children, in order to gain a better life, in order to have a newer life. In the past couple of months in Iraq, in the past 5 months, over 50,000 Iraqi youth have left Iraq. And these are the base, these are the infrastructure of the country. The youth make up the infrastructure of the country. Unfortunately, they have decided to leave their homes. Ironically, we see that there are some countries that supported war in these countries like Iraq and Syria. They supported radical groups in Syria and Iraq, all in the name of Syrian people, to bring freedom and peace to the Syrian people. They promoted war. They brought weapons into these countries. They supported radical groups. But now that the Syrian and Iraqi people are fleeing these countries that you and I know very well, which countries that I'm talking about, did they welcome these refugees? Did they open their borders for these refugees? Did you see one Syrian refugee or one Iraqi refugee enter some of these oil-rich countries? Of course not. On the contrary, ironically, it is the Western countries. It is the non-Islamic countries. It is the countries that do not believe in Islam, yet some of them, they implement the teachings of Islam. They open their doors for these refugees. You know, in Iraq, in some of the riots and rallies, and I'm sad to say this, this is a sad reality, that in some of the riots and rallies, they carry the picture of Angela Merkel. And under the picture, they stated, "This is Islam." And they carried pictures of religious figures, and they had X's on those pictures. This is very sad. This is very sad because some people, they came to power opportunistically. They came to rule in the name of Islam. They said, "Elect us only to come to power," but they used and forged the name of Islam. Anyhow, people have been leaving, thousands have left, and they are landing into Europe and in the West. Of course, this is not a new phenomenon. This is not something new. People from the Middle East have been migrating for the past decades. You and I landed in the West because of migration. People like us migrated from the Middle East and from other parts of the world, and we came to the West. Thus, this is not a new phenomenon. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Migration opens doors of opportunity. Opportunities that these people, we're not just speaking about the migration that is occurring now, the recent migration, even in the past. Migration opens lots of doors of opportunity. Opportunities that we never had in our countries, we now have by migrating in the West. Number one, education. The education, the proper education that we could not have back home, we can now have in Western countries for our children. You know, education is the number one priority for most parents. It's one of the things that most parents think about, is providing their children with quality education. And unfortunately today, quality education has become a hot commodity in our countries, in Islamic countries. Where do you find quality education? Where children could go and learn quality education, could go into good universities, into good colleges. This is not something available in our countries, but it's available in the West. Jobs and the ability to work, the opportunity to work, this is also among the opportunities here in the West. For those that never had the opportunity to work, to open a business, whether it's a small business or a big business, they never had the opportunity. Today, in the West, they have that opportunity to start a business that you'd like. Whether it's a small business or a big business, you have that opportunity. Number three, you have the opportunity, these migrants, today they have the opportunity to own a home. For many, it was a dream to own a home or a small apartment, even if it's 20 meters or 30 meters. Today, that dream can come to reality. They can own an apartment or a home. There's the opportunity to take a mortgage, to take on loans, to have credit cards, to buy things that they never were able to buy before. Number four, they have the opportunity to practice their religion freely. In the West, they're not persecuted. They're not afraid of a gang called ISIS. They can enter into their mosque and open fire upon those that are praying Salatul Jumu'ah. Unfortunately, this threat exists in our countries, back home in the Middle East. Which country does not have this threat? In the past year, we saw countries that were relatively safe, that were never victims of terrorism, but this year they became victims of terrorism. This year, back in the Middle East, in almost every country in the Middle East, when people go for Salatul Jum'ah to their local mosques, when they leave their homes, there's always the fear of never being able to come back home. Because there's a fear of a radical jihadi or a radical Wahhabi that will come inside the mosque and open fire and kill worshippers. Not in the middle of a battlefield, but in the mosque, in a masjid, in a house of Allah. Didn't we see this year in the month of Ramadan, the month of Allah, and in the house of Allah, the guests of Allah praying Salatul Jum'ah, and someone comes and he explodes himself in that mosque? These are innocent people. Were they carrying weapons? Were they able to defend themselves? Thus, this is a threat back home. If there's no terrorism, there's persecution. You're not allowed to worship the way that you want. You're not allowed to say what you want. You're not allowed to perform your rituals the way you want. But here, you could do whatever you'd like. You could say whatever you'd like. You could worship in whatever way you'd like. You could perform the rituals of Ashura and the rituals of Muharram in any way you'd like, and no one will bother you. This is an opportunity. This is an opportunity. And of course, with opportunities come challenges. Challenges also come. Moving and migrating to the West opens a lot of challenges. One of the barriers is the language barrier. Some will come not knowing how to speak the language. And that will be a major obstacle, be a major barrier. When you don't speak the language, that means you're paralyzed. That means there's only so much that you could do. And unfortunately, in our communities, in many communities, picking up the language of the new country that you go to is not something easy. And it's not part of the priority. There are some that come to the West and they spend decades and they barely speak the language of that country. This is a challenge. Among the challenges is the clash of cultures and the clash of civilizations. Many of these migrants, they come to a new country that has a new culture, new customs, new way of living. For example, women and men are treated equally. Women work the same way as men work. This is a culture that has pets. In fact, pets are more cared for than some children and some human beings. Everything goes by the book. There's a law. Everything has order. Everything is punctual. As we saw today, we started right on time. And we're expected to end on time, so I have to rush. Everything is punctual. Everything is according to time and according to order. Now for some of us that come from chaotic countries that has absolutely no respect and for time and no sense of time, that will create a clash. That will be a problem. Among the challenges, and this is one of the biggest challenges that these migrants will face, is the abundance of freedom. They will come to a country in which there's bars, there's nightclubs, there's alcohol, there's drugs, there's promiscuity, there's friends that are not religious. Their children will enroll into schools that are not Islamic. They will have friends that are not Muslim. Their children will be tempted to go into dating and to have boyfriends or girlfriends. These are all challenges. Their young teenagers will have driver's licenses and they will begin to drive. This is a lot of freedom. You know, freedom is a challenge. It's an opportunity, and at the same time, it's a challenge as well. It's a major test. For some of these migrants, some of them, they will lose their children. And when I say they lose, I don't mean they lose their lives. They lose them physically. No, physically, they will have their children, but they will lose them spiritually. They will lose them to temptations. And others, they will lose themselves. Not only will they lose their children, but they will lose themselves. Among the challenges is that religion is not so accessible. Back home, they will live in a country in which they would hear the sound of the adhan day in, day out. There are local mosques everywhere. There are masajid. The sight of hijab is everywhere. Halal food is everywhere. Religion is so accessible. Ulama and scholars are so abundant. Now they've come to a country in which halal food is scarce. Islamic centers are very rare. Ulama are very rare. And so on and so forth. This also poses a challenge. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. There's opportunities, there's challenges, and there's responsibilities, of course. These migrants should know that moving and migrating to the West, as we had experience by migrating to the West, these new migrants should also know that moving to the West has lots of responsibilities. They are responsible. You know, moving to the West gives you a lot. You gain a citizenship. You gain a good passport that gives you the chance to visit many countries without being questioned, without being asked. Moving to the West, you know, it gives you housing. You get a house. You get a salary. You get an income. You get medical benefits. You gain so much. But at the same time, you lose a lot as well. There are some that move to these countries and they lose their family members. They lose their family. They lose their family values. You see, this family, when they were back home, they had strong family values. The husband, the wife, and the children, they would gather during lunch, during dinner. They would see each other. Now that they've come to this country, they come to the West, they meet maybe once a week. The husband is busy, and the wife is busy, and the children are busy. Perhaps the children even move out. They move out of their homes and they move to other cities for college and for universities. They lose the family values. This daughter that would wear perfect hijab, now she's moved to a country and she doesn't take her hijab seriously. His son that was extremely religious, that would not miss his salah and would pray on time, now is missing his salah. Now, if he has the chance, he prays, and if he doesn't, it's not very important for him. And so on and so forth. Thus, there are some, when they come to the West, they think about the things that they gain. They forget about the things that they will lose. there's a great responsibility on the shoulder of the migrants, that when you come, don't forget that you're a Muslim. We are Muslims first. Our Islam should be a priority. The rest is second. Gaining a house, a home, a salary, medical benefits. These are important, but not as important as our Islam. As a religious institution, we also have a responsibility towards these migrants. We have a responsibility. You know, many of these migrants that will come, thousands of migrants. Germany alone accepted 800,000 migrants. Only in Germany, 800,000. There's a very big number. And all of these migrants, they're Muslim. Don't they need Islamic centers? Don't they need Husseiniyas? Don't they need mosques? This is the job of the marji'iyya, of our scholars and of our maraji', to make use of khums money, to spend the khums to build centers, mosques, Islamic centers, Husseiniyya. Not just that, but to build madrasas, build Islamic schools, even cemeteries, even mortuaries, even muhtasalat, washing places of the dead. These are all necessities and needs of this large Islamic community in the West. The marji'iyya should think very carefully about providing, catering for the needs of this Islamic community in the West. They are also in need of scholars. Islamic centers without scholars are like hospitals without doctors. What's the purpose of having an Islamic center without a scholar? The religious institution should also provide these Islamic communities with scholars that have been educated in Qom or Najaf or Karbala, that are equipped with an Islamic education and can also speak the language. Don't send us someone that does not speak English or French or German or does not speak the European or Western language. They need to be equipped with that language as well in order to be able to cater to the needs of that community. Many of these migrants are followers of the school of thought of the Sahaba. They are from our Sunni brothers and sisters. You know, this is an opportunity. We could not reach them when they were in Syria. We could not reach them when they were in Mosul. We could not reach them when they were in Fallujah, when they were in these areas that were not safe to go into. But now that they've come to the West, what excuse do we have? This is an opportunity for us to deliver the message of Ahlul Bayt to these people, to expose them to the message of Ahlul Bayt, to expose them to the message of Imam Hussein. This is an opportunity. Before Christian missionaries start working, you know, today, now that there's 800,000 Muslims going to Germany, do you think that the Catholic Church and Christian Church, they're not thinking of converting them into Christianity? Of course they are. And I'm sure that they're beginning to work from today. They're going to begin to get these Muslims to convert into Christianity. And I'm sure that that's not going to be very difficult, because they came from Islamic countries who in their eyes, they're backward countries. They did not provide them with opportunities. And who is providing them with opportunities? The non-Islamic countries. Remember the picture of Angela Merkel? Thus, it will be easy for Christians to convert them to Islam. Let's work. Let's work before others get to them. Let's introduce them to the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt, to the school of thought of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, before others tempt them and they brainwash them. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Is the first of Muharram a day of celebration, my dear brothers and sisters? There are some today, they're celebrating and they're congratulating each other. They congratulate each other for the beginning of the new year, the Islamic year. But we, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we have nothing to celebrate for. Because when we see the moon of Muharram, I was telling one of the brothers that brought me to the mosque, when we got in the car, I saw the moon of the month of Muharram. Wow. I told him then, you know, our imams, Imam al-Sadiq, Imam al-Kadhim, Imam al-Rida, when they would see the moon of Muharram, they would begin to weep. They would begin to cry because it reminded them of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Thus, today is not a day of celebration. Today is a day of mourning because it's in the beginning of Muharram. Let's remember the one that migrated from Medina to Karbala, the one who left his city of Medina, the one who left his hometown, the one who came to say his farewell to his grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and to his mother Fatima al-Zahra, and to his brother al-Hasan, who wanted to leave the city and to move to another city by the name of Karbala, because he was forced to give allegiance to a ruthless tyrant, to a ruthless dictator by the name of Yazid. He was asked to give his allegiance. Imam Hussein alayhi salam stated, وَمِثْلِي لَا يُبَايُعُ مِثْلَهُ. A person like me will never give allegiance to a person like Yazid. I am from the household of Rasulullah. إِنَّا أَهْلُ بَيْتِ النُّبُوَّةِ وَمَوْضَعَ الرَّسَالَةِ. I am from the household of Rasulullah. You expect me to give my allegiance to Yazid? Yazid, the one who would drink alcohol? Yazid, the promiscuous? Yazid, the one who would kill innocent lives? وَمِثْلِي لَا يُبَايُعُ مِثْلَهُ. Imam Hussein alayhi salam came to the shrine of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He entered the shrine of Rasulullah. He came to the grave of Rasulullah. He sat next to the grave of Rasulullah and he began weeping. Ya Rasulullah, look at what your nation has done to me. Ya Rasulullah, look at what your nation has done to your family, to your Ahlul Bayt. Ya Rasulullah, take me in your grave. Imam Hussein put his head on the grave of Rasulullah. In his sleep, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi saw Rasulullah. In his dream, he saw Rasulullah approaching him with a group of angels on his right and on his left, behind him and in front of him. Rasulullah embraced his grandson Hussein. Imam Hussein told his grandfather in his dream, take me inside your grave, my grandfather. I don't wish to come back to this life. Rasulullah told his grandson Hussein, we are missing you, your father Ali, your mother Fatima, your brother Hassan, we all miss you. We're all waiting for you to come. However, you must reach the stage of Shahada. Imam Hussein wakes up. He says his farewell to his father, Rasulullah. And then he goes to another grave, to the grave of his mother Fatima, to that lonely grave, to the grave that we don't know of its location. He says his farewell to his mother Fatima. He says his farewell to his brother Hassan. And Imam Hussein and his caravan, they set off from Medina. And there was another day in which the caravan of Imam Hussein came back to Medina. But in that caravan, Imam Hussein was not there. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was not in the caravan. Al-Qasim and Ali al-Akbar were not in the caravan. The caravan was headed by Imam Zayn al-Abidin. The caravan was headed by Sayyida Zaynab. When she set her eyes on the city of Medina, she said, مدينة جدنا لا تقبلينا فبلا هايات والحسرات جينا خرجنا من كمل أهل جمعا رجعنا لا رجال ولا بنينا Oh, the city of Medina, Medina, Medina. When we left you, I had my brothers, I had my children all together with me. Oh, now, the city of Medina, I come back to you, but without my brothers, without my sons, without my nephews. Oh, the people of Medina, if you ask me, where's your brother? I tell you, I left him without a burial in the city of Karbala, Karbala, Karbala. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. Raise your hands in dua. نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا عيبا إلا سترته ولا خوفا إلا آمنته ولا رزقا إلا بسطته ولا شملا إلا جمعته ولا مرضا إلا شفيته ولا غائبا إلا حفظته وأدنيته ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة لك فيها رضا ولنا فيها صلاح إلا قضيتها ويسرتها يا أرحم الراحمين ولأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نقرأ سورة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
اللهم صل على